Hello, this is Renaud Anjoran, the author of this article. If you're reading this, you're probably interested in how to manage your product quality. Are you buying from China or some other Asian countries? I believe this video will be useful for you.
Reducing your quality risks and setting up a coherent quality assurance policy for buying in China. This is what we'll cover. First, what are the risks, the most common risks for buyers and the common pitfalls that they tend to fall into? I will introduce a very powerful framework that will help you understand what really needs to be done, and then I will cover some specific points, the approved samples and what to use them for and how to use them, the specification sheet, which becomes the QC checklist, why you need one, what it looks like, and so on, a list of potential defects, again, why you need it, how it's going to be used, what it looks like, a few words about the contracts, and then I will cover sample reviews and product inspections and the way they use the QC checklist and the approved samples. So all of this is really foundational work for confirming that what you are buying is up to your standard. A few words about myself. I've been working in China for 13 years. I've been directly working in quality assurance for more than 11 years. And I write this blog at qualityinspection.org. So let's start with the basic homework. What I consider really the basic homework of the buyer is to document your requirements. You can't expect the Chinese supplier to do this, especially small to medium-sized Chinese suppliers. This would just not happen. So sometimes they will have some kind of detailed specification sheet. That's great, especially if you buy, let's say, electronic products. It's a good starting point, but most of the time they will not have this kind of specification sheet. Okay, they will have close to nothing, and they see it as something that is in their interest to protect themselves. Okay, if something is not defined and documented, well, it gives them the freedom to choose the cheapest option. All right. Very often, for example, the packing is not defined by the buyer. So at the last moment, someone in the factory says, hey, let's buy this kind of packing, it's cheaper. But is it going to be the best packing for you to present your products, to protect them and so on? Sometimes not. And also, they can't be pinned down for doing something wrong since they did not promise anything, all right? The risk of poor quality. If you are starting to buy from China, maybe you haven't realized that, but after the supplier shipped the goods out, it's too late to send the goods back. And sometimes, and it's happened many, many times, the products are not checked in China, nothing has been documented, communicated properly to the supplier, and an entire batch has to be thrown away, or maybe it has to be sorted out, and the product has to be reworked, maybe half of them need to be thrown away. A very heavy loss, all right? So the three realities. A batch of defective products is very hard to send back to China. Suing a Chinese company is seldom the answer, and what is bad quality for you might be okay for a 20-year-old operator who grew up in the mountains of Sichuan and just started to work in a factory in Dongguan. Right, so you need to really describe what you expect. A few common pitfalls that we see a lot of buyers fall into. You don't have a view of the milestones. You don't really have a purchasing process and a quality assurance process. All right, so you let the supplier lead the conversation, and they are the one who suggests the next step. Well, guess what? A few steps that are there to defend your interest might be missing here. Communicating via emails, Skype, WeChat, and so on for several months and failing to document everything that was agreed on in one document, then it becomes pretty much impossible to have an overview of all the specifications that that you and the supplier agreed on. Working solely on the basis of a sample approval. This is especially common for apparel, home textile, and so on. It's not enough. You also need specification sheet, which becomes a QC checklist. We'll cover that. The terms, that you need to specify, for example, on your purchase order, your contract, and so on. Also very, very important, we'll cover that. Regulatory standards for compliance, this is something you need to research. And trusting too much what the supplier says, even though you've only been working with them for a few months. This is also a sign of an inexperienced importer. What I want to introduce here is this framework. It's like a triangle, okay? And I'm gonna cover each of these points one by one. But the three main points are product specifications, which becomes a QC checklist, sample reviews before and during production, and inspections at the factory. Okay, it's like a triangle. And this is the 20% that will cover 80% of what you need if you do this the right way. Let's start with an approved sample. Okay, so an approved sample is, it's good. Okay, you get a sample and you say, okay, this is what I want you to produce. But it's useful for illustrating the touch and feel of the products, because that's pretty much impossible to describe very clearly in words, and the color. All right, you can use Pantone codes and so on, but really, with a lot of materials, it's better to have an exact sample in that exact material. Okay, so it becomes a standard. You validate it. You can also maybe show it to some of your customers, validate that you can sell that product. Great. You need an approved sample, but it's not enough. Okay, so it's not enough. You need a product checklist. What is the role of the product checklist? You set your expectations in a necessary level of detail. All right, so what is this component made of? What is this dimension supposed to be? And so on. We'll cover that. And it becomes also part of your standard. And then it becomes a checklist for QC inspections, but also for sample reviews. What is very, very important, and a lot of first-time importers don't realize this, is you need to clarify your requirements in advance. So imagine the following scenario. You find a supplier with a nice sample. You say, okay, I give you an order. You wire the deposit. They make production, and then you notice some issues. Hopefully before production, before shipment, maybe after shipment. What are you going to tell them? This is not good, but what are they going to tell you? Oh, this issue we think is quite minor. Oh, all our other customers accept it. Oh, you did not tell us about it, and so on. And then what do? You can't negotiate anything. You are not in a position of strength because you never actually specified what you expected. So this is really a rookie mistake you need to avoid. Now, specification sheet, which becomes the checklist for the inspector, what does it include? So what's expected? Again, this box is supposed to be this kind of yellow and with this kind of dimensions and so on. The tolerances, okay, anything that can be measured, if possible, give it a tolerance, all right? Because if it's supposed to be 10.0 centimeter long, what if it's 10.1 centimeter long? Is it going to create a problem or not? You know, where is the limit? Because it's never going to be 10.0000. And there's going to be variation within the batch also. Some of them might be 10.0, some of them might be 10.05, 10.1, and so on. Okay, where is the limit? Also, talking about the product, it's your product, but you also need to think of the labeling and the packaging and the packing of the product. You need to define it. Many people forget about that. And what are the potential defects? Try to think of them in advance. All right, so this is an example, different points that can be measured. For an example of a lipstick, for example, you can, for example, lipstick 12 mm plus or minus 5%. Okay, this is very, very loose tolerances, but this is just an example. Checkpoint by checkpoint, because this is what your inspector will check and confirm. And what is the requirement with the tolerance wherever possible? Talking about tolerances, the tighter you go into the tolerances, the higher the cost. Okay, this is an example with the finishing of a metal product, but this applies to many other situations as well. So be realistic also. You need to understand a little bit about the production process. Packaging and labeling, as I mentioned, very important. People tend to forget about it. Not only what is it supposed to be made of and how is it all supposed to be packaged, but also maybe what kind of test is it supposed to pass. If you sell under the fulfillment by Amazon model, there will be some extra requirements. I hope you consult the Amazon website at that time or ask us, and we know that pretty well. We follow that as these requirements evolve. Potential defects, you also need to think of what might go wrong. This is also something where you just have a sample in hand. You can't really tell where the limit is. If there's a little dent, a little scratch, if it's not visible even from 30 centimeter away in clear lighting, is it a problem or not? You need to define these kind of things. Now, you can have a full defect list, right, with like 1,000 potential defects. You can again target the 20% of defects that would appear 80% of the time. So for example, insects or hair, that would be considered critical. Pretty much nobody wants that. Even if it's only on one piece in the shipment, this is just unacceptable. All right. Scratches, if there are large scratches, they will be considered major. If they're really small, they might be considered minor. All right. So these are examples here. And sometimes you will need to illustrate this with a photo. Let's say, for example, this is the worst you can accept. Okay, this is perfect, but you know that there's going to be some porosity, some of these imperfections in this cast piece. So you take a cross section, take a photo, and you say this is the limit. Anything worse than that, totally unacceptable. Like, this is totally unacceptable. This is the limit. So anything between this and this is acceptable. This is a good way of describing your standard. People usually follow the same way of classifying defects, and so most people follow this. There's critical defects, major defects, minor defects, and for each of them you want to set a limit. It's 0% for critical. This is really the things you absolutely cannot accept. 2.5% for major defects. This is typically what a consumer in a store would notice and then would not buy the product, or might even send it back if they see it later. Okay, and then minor defects. These are really like imperfections. You don't want too many of these. Okay, so these are very typical types of acceptance limits. It does vary. Not everybody does that. I mentioned the terms that you need to mention on your purchase order. Well, here are some typical terms. And as you can see in orange, it should mention your defect list and also your approved sample and also your QC checklist or product specification, whatever you call it. All right. And if there's any failure in inspection or maybe testing, it should be at the cost of the supplier. All of this, if you get it written in advance and confirmed again in written by the supplier in advance before you wire any money, it's going to be much easier to enforce. This is a couple of tables that you need to be a little bit familiar with. Okay, so we call it, most people call it the AQL tables. All right, so let's say you purchase a batch of 5,000 pieces. Is going to be here in level 2, which is the one used most often. The code letter is L. Now L corresponds to 200 samples. Okay, so out of 5,000 pieces in your batch, the inspector will pick 200 pieces, and then the limit will be zero, obviously, for critical defects. And then if you set 2.5% for major defect, it's this column, so maximum 10 major defects and maximum 14 minor defects. If the inspector finds, let's say, 11 major defects, it's failed, the inspection is failed. All right, this is very clear. Pretty much all suppliers are comfortable with this, somewhat understand it, and can accept it. So I covered the product checklist. Now let's have a quick word about contracts and making things more formal. Well, the purpose of a contract is to make things more formal. If it's legally enforceable, you can actually use it as leverage if the supplier behaves very unethically and contrary to the contract you wrote with them. Now, if you're going to share any intellectual property that's very proprietary, for example, a design for a new product and so on, talk to a lawyer first and get the Chinese suppliers to sign the right kind of contract, okay? Not a typical NDA. In China, it's pretty much useless. Then, now let's look at sample reviews, okay? So sample reviews, it can happen, it happens before production. Typically, you would receive some samples from your supplier, review them yourself in your office, let's say, and all the way until you get some perfect samples that you can confirm. All right, now if it's furniture or very large pieces, obviously this is not realistic, but let's say most often this is what happens. Now keep in mind, samples are really part of the selling toolbox for the supplier. They will make them as pretty as they can. It doesn't mean production is going to be exactly the same. All right, again, that's why a QC checklist and potential defect list and so on will address that. Sample reviews also take place during production. Very common, for example, for garments. Send us the first pieces that come out of the line, you know, and then we check if you really understand everything, right? But be careful. Sometimes even these samples are made separately in a sample room or by a few engineers on a bench. That's very typical, right? This is why you still need inspections. Now, we discussed checklists, okay, and now we're talking about sample reviews. Now, when you receive the samples, you need to follow your checklist. And whenever you see some or you can think of any potential issues, you actually record them in your checklist and in your list of potential defects. Okay, this is a living document. Whenever you receive some samples, you check them according to the checklist and then you improve your checklist. This is a very important point here. Now let's talk about the timing. Okay, if you are, let's say, in the US and or in Western Europe and you get samples sent to you, The shipment by DHL, UPS, and so on will take some time. Then it's going to reach your office. Then there might be a weekend and so on. It takes time. There's a number of companies, including ourselves, in China that can receive the samples, test them, and the timing for the iterations, for giving feedback to the factory, is much tighter. Everything is much faster. Plus, we can communicate with the factory on WeChat or whatever is comfortable with them, talking with them on the phone in Chinese. That also helps. So keep this in mind. And sometimes sample reviews have to be done at the factory because they have the very special equipment in their laboratory. This is more for relatively large manufacturers in China. Okay. Now let's talk about quality inspections. When to do inspections, what kind of inspection, and so on. So if we look at production completion from, let's say, 0% production starting all the way to shipment, you can do a pre-production inspection. Let's say you buy LED lighting and you want to make sure they're going to use exactly the right kind of components. Very, very important. This is an important time for an inspection. Let's say you buy, let's say furniture, and you want to make sure that the first pieces they make that come out of the lines are okay, can be assembled properly, and so on. This would be an inspection during production, okay? So all of this is really to catch the problems as early as possible. Now, the most common type of inspection is what we call the final random inspection, when the products are packed, picked at random. The packaging and the labeling is checked, the products are checked. It really gives an idea about average quality. Some clients also need us to go on the day of the loading. So we just check the packing, We supervise the loading. Maybe they have a special plan for loading. We confirm the quantity, maybe the total weight. Okay, different clients might have different requirements here. But let's say about 90% of our work is final random inspection, and the rest is mostly inspections during production. Again, final random inspection is typically when everything is packed. This is one of our inspectors using our mobile app. So you open the cartons, you pick them at random. This is really why you can have a good idea about average quality. Now, what if it fails? Well, the final random inspection usually is done before you send the balance of the payment. Very, very important. Never pay 100% of the amount you owe the supplier before you have confirmed quality, all right? So if the quality control check is okay, then keep going and ship, pay the balance. If not, hold the payment of the balance, typically 70%. Have the supplier sort out the bad pieces, rework them, or remake some of them, and then have them book a new inspection. Again, if you follow the right terms at the beginning, this should be all already agreed on in writing, so they should not complain about that. And you can use all the data you get to challenge a factory. If you see the wrong trends over time, you can really ask them to improve, or else. Maybe you need to start looking for a new factory if things start to go downhill. All this data can also be used for classifying the most common types of defects and asking the supplier to do corrective actions, to explain where it comes from in their process and what actions they are taking to make this impossible to happen in the future. Right? So really, to sum up, this triangle is the basis of what importers need to apply to have a coherent quality assurance policy in China. Please contact us. We're happy to talk to you. Please go to this link and you will find a page with a little form to fill out, and we'll be in touch with you. You can also send me an email or reach out on Skype. Let's cover our services in relation to this video, what we covered in this video. So sample reviews in our Shenzhen office, we do visual reviews and some testing. We have some testing equipment, sometimes for something very specific, we will procure what is needed for a new kind of product. So we confirm the requirements are met, we check the samples, we do the testing, and something that our clients appreciate is that we can consolidate several samples, sometimes from different suppliers, and send them in one time, either with, let's say, DHL or FedEx, or with a local shipment company. Product checklist. If you think that this would be difficult for you or your staff to put together, this is something that we do. So we ideally with a sample in hand and already some specifications and so on that the supplier agreed on or promised. Ideally also after asking the supplier what kind of packing they would use by default, or maybe you already design your own packing. So once we have all this information, we can put it together, we can think of the potential defects and so on. All right, and the price varies, same as the sample review, with the complexity of the product. And this is the type of document that you would get. Sometimes it can go deep into the details, especially for function tests and so on. And product inspections. This is the core service of our quality assurance department. Again, as I mentioned, the main types of inspections are the during production inspection to catch the issues early, and the final random inspection, where we pull samples already packed at random. We can check the quantity, we can check average quality by pulling samples really at random from different boxes and at random within the boxes. All right, and this is usually based on a statistically valid sampling plan. I already showed you the two AQL tables, all right? And this is the price, and this is per Monday of work. And usually, if the product is not excessively complicated, and if there's only one or two or three types of products, it's one Monday. And this is the type of reports that you get with the first page. So we check all types of products. This is just an example. All right. And we go down the checklist that was agreed on before, or if you just send us your specifications, we just use them as the checklist. And we take some photos along the way to show what we have done. Again, we're waiting for you to contact us. Please don't hesitate.
Hey, if you've made it thus far, congratulations. I hope this gives you a lot of ideas for things you can do. If I summarize it very quickly, you need to work with the right type of supplier, obviously. You need to define your expectations. You need to make this into a checklist that you keep refining over time as you see some new types of defects and other issues. You need to take into account safety standards, make sure you're compliant. You need to give a lot of feedback to the supplier, not only on samples, but also with quality inspections and batches. I'm the CEO of Sofeast. We have helped hundreds of importers, mainly in China, but also in Vietnam, Taiwan, India, Bangladesh, Pakistan, Cambodia. We'll be delighted to talk to you. You will see a link on the next page. Don't hesitate, please contact us.